Bible says, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. For the Lord is good.
Yes.
Come on, somebody. If anybody can hear it, they'll live by the line. God is good. And he's worthy to be praised. I'm happy to be here. I was asking the elders earlier how long you all have been in this building, because the last time I was with you all, it was a long time ago. It had to be 5 to 7 years ago, and that building wasn't like this building. So God is good to somebody.
Yes.
And then I was told that y'all still have the old building.
Yes.
That is truly a blessing. And I shared with the elder. There's a young real estate mogul who always says there's one thing that they aren't making anymore, and that's land. So if you need to hold on to the land, do what you have to do. So praise God for what he's doing for you all. And I'm thankful for your pastor. He is a good friend of mine. He is a good friend of mine, and I know that he is a blessing to you. I'm going to ask that you would, in a special way, pray for him. I don't know if you all know, but his former church, this morning, they lost a youth director. Their youth director died this morning. She was 35 years old.
Wow.
She worked at school. My son's attend the Millennium Academy. She had an asthma attack, ended up going into cardiac arrest. I think she had 2 cardiac arrests, something like that. She was on life support on Thursday. They did brain function tests to see if there was any functioning of her brain. Every test that they did, she failed. So they tried to wait for a family to get in town, and then last night they decided to pull the plug, and then this morning she breathed her last breath. So this morning, Pappas is dealing with that. Also, it is their pastor's last day, so it's going to be an emotional day. So I'm going to ask that you will pray for them, pray for that family, pray for the school, all the students at Energy Academy. They were very close to her. If you walked in the office, you would always see her smiling face. Anything you needed, she was always there to help you. So I'm going to ask you to remember her. Her name is Marquita Bliss. Is her name? Marquita Bliss. So remember her family. I know her parents came into town. I'm not sure who else made it. But remember them in prayer. This morning, I won't take too much of your time. Your pastor always tells me that he doesn't speak long. So I don't know if that's true or not. I'm going to believe him. So keep with that tradition. I promise I won't speak too long. Under one condition, you must stay awake.
Amen.
And that's how I know you're awake, by saying amen.
Amen.
Brother Howard, it's good to see you. It's good to see you, Brother Howard. If you would turn with me, I know we read John 12:28-32. And that was just a launching pad, but I want you to turn with me to Matthew chapter 27. Chapter 27 and verse 46. This morning we're going to go to an old well and try to find some fresh water. Is that all right? Matthew chapter 27 and verse 46. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
If you're still searching, say, Lord, have mercy. Matthew, the first book in the New Testament, the first of the 4 Gospels. The Bible says there, and at about the 9th hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Some of them that stood there, when they heard that, said, this man calleth for Elias. And straightway one of them ran, and took a sponge and filled it with vinegar, put it on a reed, and gave him to drink. The rest said, Let us see whether Elias will come to save him. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. This morning I want to preach or speak on the subject just for a few minutes. I'm in the picture. I'm in the picture. Let us pray. God, we thank you. We ask that now you will speak clearly to us. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to thank the musicians, the praise team, and everybody else who helped enter us into the presence of God. Aren't they doing a wonderful job?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. I've been places where there was no music. And we struggled through it. So you have to be thankful to God when you have musicians. Amen. The cross, it rests on the timeline of history like a compelling or beautiful diamond. Its tragedy summons all sufferers. Its absurdity attracts all critics. Its hope lures all searchers. History has idolized it and despised it. Some have even gold-plated it, and then others have burned. Some have worn it and some have trashed it. History has done everything to it but ignore it. That's the one option that the cross does not offer. No one can ignore it. You can't ignore a piece of lumber that suspends the greatest claim in history. A crucified carpenter claiming that he is God on earth. The cross, its bottom line is sobering, but if this account is true, it is a historical hinge. Here we find Matthew portraying for us a snapshot of what's going on. And if I can pause it parenthetically, and if I can make it clear to you, Matthew has taken a group picture. Have any of you ever taken a group picture before?
Yes.
Whenever you try to take a group picture, it's probably one of the most confusing things ever. Because some people want to smile, some people want to frown, some people want to look hard, some people aren't paying attention. You have to get people together. But the one thing about it is that as long as you are in the picture, then the photographer can do what they have to do to fix any imperfection in the picture. Today, Matthew is taking a picture of some of the people at the cross. And I guarantee you that all of us fit into one of these categories. There's going to be three categories. No one escapes his snapshots. And as we look through the photo album of the cross, I want you to look for your face in one of the crowds at the cross. Picture number one, Matthew 27:32. The first picture is those who, and it says, and as they came out, they find a man of Cyrene, Simon, by name. Him they compelled to bear his cross. The first group of people are those who are forced to the cross. Simon was a common Jewish name. He was a believer. He was not someone who was tricked into coming to church through a Sabbath potluck. He was a common believer. He was a religious man. He was a normal churchgoer. He was here for Sabbath school, for Wednesday night prayer service, for divine worship, for board meeting, for business meeting, for elders meeting, for deacon meeting, for deaconess meeting, for church cleanup. He was in the building. This picture only has one man in it. Simon, a man forced to the cross. Only one sentence in the Bible announces his presence. Only 20 English words describe his encounter with the cross. In fact, if you go to the original, there are only 14 Greek words that denote his presence. Some of you feel just like Simon. You've been coming to the cross or to church for as long as you can remember. So I want you to look for your face in this situation. Are you here in this picture? Coming to the church, I can personally say I was a drug addict. No, I wasn't addicted to heroin or cocaine, but I was drugged to church by my parents. Some of you were drugged to church by your parents. But some of you came just because family is a family tradition. Some of you, there's a husband who feels obligated to come with his wife. There's a mother who only comes for her children. There are some preachers who only come to church because they get paid to come to church every week. Some of you come out of tradition. Others feel that it makes your role in the community a little better to say that I'm a member of Emmanuel S.D.A. Church. But everyone has one common thread that is laced through this photo, and that they are all forced. Here's one lesson we need to learn. Out of everyone in these three photos that we'll talk about, Simon, the religious guy, is the closest to the cross, listen to me, but it is never recorded that he was changed by the cross. The horizontal beam of God's love was on his very back, but never in the rest of the New Testament do we hear his conversion. Never do we see him run home and tell his wife that he carried a cross for God. Lesson number one is this. You can be close to the cross, but far from Christ. You can be a member of the church, but never be a Christian. Your name can be written on the church register, but it will never be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Simon isn't alone. The second picture is also a picture of churchgoers. These are what we call surface believers that touch the cross, but they never let the cross touch them. The second picture are those who we will call the foolish at the cross. So the first was the forced at the cross. The second is the foolish at the cross. Verses 38 through 44 says, "Then were there two thieves crucified with him, one on the right hand and another on the left. And they that passed by reviled him, wagging their heads, and saying, Thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself. If thou be the Son of God, come down from the cross. Likewise also the chief priests mocking him with the scribes and elders." Read that again. "Likewise also the chief priests mocking him with the scribes and the elders. And they said, He saved others, himself he cannot save. If he be the king of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusted in God, let him deliver him now, if he will have him. For he said, I am the Son of God. The thieves also, which were crucified with him, cast the same in his teeth." There are three different people in this picture. The soldiers, three that I want you to pay attention to. The soldiers, the crowd, and the religious leaders. The soldiers, the crowd, and the religious leaders. And possibly, if some of us were honest with ourselves, we can be in this picture as well. You see, these are the people that make a mockery of the cross. Some people are silent, and some people are loud at their oppression to the cross. If I can pause that parenthetically. It is funny in this world that people will get mad at a football star for kneeling. When the national anthem is played. But those same people won't have a word to say when people are being slaughtered in the streets by public servants. And it's even more oppressive when we have a world church that doesn't have a thing to say about oppression. But they have a lot to say about women being ordained. But they don't see anything different that you to share with them. They will ask, where is this Jesus that you're preaching about? Where is this love that you're talking about? Until we're willing to move out of our comfort zones. I'm sorry I have to be the bearer of bad news. But God didn't create you just to come to church one day of the week. God didn't bless you with the blessing that you have just so you can come inside the four walls of a church with nice AC and plush seats just to say amen. We all have a personal mission that we must proclaim. If not, we will be missing out on God's gracious blessings for us. And it hurts my heart because back in the civil rights days, you know who led out in that battle? It was the black church. It was the black church. But now we've become so politically correct and so comfortable that now we have our own that we figure out as long as it doesn't affect me, then I'm okay. But I have bad news for you. One day it's going to come knocking at your door. And you want to realize that I should have said something when it was affecting somebody else because now it's affecting me and I want somebody to help me.
Yeah.
Wow, y'all want to hear that. Let me get back to the Bible. Y'all come here with the Bible.
Please, Pastor.
That's right.
Wow.
This group, the religious, those who claim the heritage of the cross, to be honest, I'm thinking about all of us. Every person in this room, the stuffy, the loose, the straight, the conservative, the liberal, the simple, church officers, members, those in ties and three-piece suits, those ladies with nice hats, I'm thinking of all of us. We too are like the soldiers and we play games at the cross. We compete for church titles. It's getting quiet now. I've been in this thing a long time. I know how it goes. Nominating coming up soon. We scramble for status. We are so close, listen to this, we are so close to the timber of the cross, but so far from the blood that was shed. We huddle around world events, and as soon as the Pope says something, the Adventist church gets scared. Let the Pope do something, and we get scared. When there's stuff going around us every day that we say nothing about.
Amen.
We gripe. We gossip, and we bicker over opinions, not things that are salvific in nature, but things that are simply opinions. We are so close to the cross, but so far from Christ. From the other gospels, their albums, we see that people or the crowd actually spit on Jesus. And this is the ultimate insult, not to almost everybody, but to the Jews, because when the spit of a non-Jew came into contact with a Jew, they were immediately considered unclean. And therefore, they would send the Jewish prisoner or the executioner directly to an execution without having a chance of him being ceremonially cleaned. Even the religious leaders, even the conference officials, even the elders of the church, even the pastors, even the members, even the religious leaders hurled insults and quoted his own words at him. Their education and pride would not allow God to die on the cross for them. They were above reproach, reproof, and repentance. The scary thing about this photo is that all of us have probably been in the first two photos at some point in our lives. We've either been forced to the cross or we sat foolishly at the cross. But out of the three photos, there really are only two categories of people. Those who were touched by choice and those who were touched by chains. The first two photos were people who were touched by chains. But the last photo is one that you can only get in by choice. Picture three. is for those that were forgiven through the cross. Verse 45 to 54, I'm going to read very quickly. Now from the sixth hour, there was darkness all over the land, and unto the ninth hour, as I read before, and at about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Some of them stood there, and they heard that, said, this man calleth for Elias, Elias. And straightway one of them ran and took a sponge and filled it with vinegar, and put it on his own tree, and gave it to him to drink. We read through that. Now go down to verse 54, says, now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, this was truly the Son of God. The faces in this picture are the least likely candidates. They are the people who sit in the back. They are the people who come to church and never know their names. They're the people who never ask for a position. They're the people who are just happy to be in the church. Amen. One more time.
Amen.
These faces will not be found on America's most successful people. They would never be promoted on People or Time magazines. He began, his face in verse 44. Where it says, the thieves also which were crucified with him cast the same in his teeth. Now Matthew doesn't talk about this anymore. But have you ever been to a wedding? And at a wedding you see they may have more than one photographer. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
Because one thing that one photographer might miss, the other photographer will catch.
Amen.
Thank God that we have more than one photographer painting this picture, because there is a second photographer. Luke chapter 23, verse 39. If you turn there when you're free time, the Bible lets us know that one of those two thieves, in his last ditch effort, asked God, God, listen, told Jesus, it seems like you're about to die, but I want you to please ask your Father to remember me. And Jesus said, this day you will be saved. The message of this is that no matter where you are at the cross, as long as you are in the picture, then you have an opportunity to be forgiven through the cross. God doesn't care about how your proofs look. He only cares with what your gloss finishes look like. The criminal, the reason why he was like a least likely candidate, he was an ex-con, and he is asking God for eternal life. He deserves hell, but he gets heaven.
Yeah.
Only Luke's photo album has a snapshot of the criminal asking Jesus to remember him in his Father's kingdom, and Jesus granted his request. Why did we place such low value on this picture? Because in our world, we believe that I have to work in order to be saved. We believe I have to attend enough Sabbath services in order to be saved. We believe that there is something good in us that will enable us to be saved. But I'm here to let you know that there is no other name by which any man can be saved but in the name of Jesus. And Jesus said, if you believe on me, then you shall be saved. He didn't say if you show up to 365 Sabbath services. He didn't say if you had an office in the church. He didn't say if you returned a faithful tithe. He said, if you believe on my name, shall be saved.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
In God's soul, a person is worth something just because he or she is a person. Maybe the criminal had heard Jesus speak. Maybe he had seen him love the lowly. Maybe he had watched him hang out with the putrid, the pickpocketers, and the prostitutes. Or maybe he just saw what he sees now. And what the centurion saw when he said, surely this was the Son of God. What did they see? They saw a beaten, slashed, nail-suspended preacher. His face crimson with blood. His bones peeking through the torn flesh. His body heaving for air. And the criminal asked, in the middle of Jesus' suffering, asked, is there any chance you could put in a good word for me? And Jesus stopped dying for a second. Jesus stopped dying. He put death on pause. Said, "Death, hold on. I'm not ready to die right uncomfortable with that picture. I've heard arguments about, well, that just happened and that can't really happen now. There's no way I could be about to die and Jesus will save me. And that's why we struggle with people who commit suicide, people who we quote unquote weren't living right, but they died. We have a problem because we try to put people in heaven or in hell. But the last time I checked, you don't have heaven or hell to put nobody in. You need to worry about your own salvation with fear and trembling. In this picture, a pagan ex-con and a centurion are saved. Why are we uncomfortable with the ex-con walking the golden streets? Who knows more about grace, listen to this, than 1,000 theologians? Why don't we like it? I think I have the answer. One of the hardest things for church-going, Bible-toting, scripture-knowing, hymn-singing, tithe-praying Christians is to be saved by grace. There's something in us that reacts when we hear of God's free gift. Can it really be free? We have some weird compulsion to create laws and regulations that will make me worthy of God's gift. It is pride that keeps us out of this forum. To accept grace means that I realize I am helpless and I cannot save myself. If a picture paints 1,000 words, the centurion and the thief got a dictionary full. We are uncomfortable with the doctrine of substitution and imputation. When Jesus died on the cross, did he become a sinner? No. He became a sin offering for us. He took our place, and this doctrine is called substitution. Jesus lived a perfect life so that his life would be accredited to your account. Now, I know everybody here has seen a sporting event. And in most team sports, they have substitution. But one of the most interesting substitutions happens in volleyball. I coached volleyball for 2 or 3 years, and in volleyball, in order for you to substitute, you have to come to the line. Your partner has to come to the line. Normally they touch hands and they have to wait to be called into the game. And no matter what you did before in the game, when your substitute comes in, they can make the team win. Somebody missed it. So no matter what happened in your past, no matter what life you have lived before, when you accept Jesus as your personal Savior, then he substitutes everything that you were before. So in other words, God allowed Jesus to take your punishment. Matthew K., I'm almost done, writes a lot of these words in his book. No wonder they call him Savior. He says, like a master painter, God reserved his masterpiece until the end. All the earlier acts of love had been leading to this one. God unveils the canvas, and the ultimate act of creative compassion is revealed. The creator being sacrificed for the creation. God commits man once and for all that forgiveness still follows failure. Amen. Jesus had to die in order to make room for you in the family portrait. What photograph are you in today? Are you still forced at the cross? Are you still foolish at the cross? Or are you ready to be forgiven through the cross? Those with whom were forced to the cross, are you still there? Are you still at the snapshot of those who were foolish at the cross? If you are, then you need to know that God has a camera in hand.
All right. Amen.
And he wants to take a picture of you finding forgiveness through the cross.
Amen.
There's a story, you can say something, let me give it to you. There's a story of a father and a son. These two were hooked together, they were close. See, what had happened earlier, the mother died of cancer. And for years, the father and son grew closer together due to the absence. The boy grew up to become a young man, and suddenly he was drafted into the Vietnam War. The father's heart was broken and lonely. A few years had passed. The father got a report that his son had been killed in combat. Within a few months, a trans knock came knocking at the door. It was a young man with one arm blown off. Beneath his good arm was a photo wrapped in brown paper. The young man spoke and said, "Sir, you do not know me, but I wanted you to know that your son saved my life. He took the bullet so I would not have to. And your son meant so much to me that I painted this picture of him." The soldier handed the picture to the proud father. The father unwrapped it, and in there he found a badly painted picture of his son. You see, the father was a wealthy man. He collected a lot of fine art. So he had things like Picasso and Van Gogh hanging in his art collection. But what he did, he took down one of those expensive portraits and he hung the portrait of his son there in his place. Years went by, the father grew old and weak and he died. There was supposed to be an auction of the house, and in the auction of the house, everything had to go. There were people came from all over the world because they knew this father was a collector of great art. So the auctioneer started the auction with the painting of the son, the worst painting out of everything in there. As the auctioneer started to auction off the people who were anticipating the expensive painting, they began to growl and yell, "Come on with the good stuff, take that ass and stuff out of here." The auctioneer, he started off and said, who made the first bid? $1. Maybe $2. Up from the back came this old gardener. This old gardener, he had watched his son grow up. So he had a special bond with the son. He understood. So the gardener bought the picture. And he walked down the aisle with the picture tucked beneath his arm. And at that moment, the auctioneer slammed his gavel and said, "The auction is closed." The people wondered what was going on. And the auctioneer said, "In the will, it reads, whoever has the son gets it all." Now, I'm not your pastor, so I don't know your problems. I'm not a counselor, so you don't come to me to tell what's going on in your life. But one thing I do know about life is that no matter what problems you have, there always has to be a solution.
Yes.
So today I come to you with the only solution I know, and his name is Jesus.
Yes.
Wherever you are, whatever you're going through right now, I want you to close your eyes and bow your heads. Wherever you are, whatever you're going through, whatever the problem is, it could be financial, it could be family, it could be problems with school, it could be problems with life, it could be just you're fed up, you're tired. You need something different in your life. You're tired of having the problems and you need a solution. Whatever it is in your life, and I want you to take this seriously. You want to say, "I tried everything else, but now I need to try Jesus." If that's you, I want you to stand up. The auctioneer said, whoever has a son takes it all. Earlier we read, the Bible says where it says, Jesus said, "And if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me." No matter what your problem is, if you bring it to Jesus and you accept him as a son, he will handle it all. Let us pray. God, we thank you so much for sending your son whose name is Jesus. God, we thank you that we don't have to do a 12-step process. We thank you that we don't have to go through some type of program. But God, in a moment's notice, we can say, "Jesus, save me," and we will be saved. So God, so much for your son. We thank you for blessing us. We thank you for hearing us. In Jesus' name, everybody believes in him, say amen.